Hi guys, it's Toddy here from Rekombu, and in front of me I have the Kodak Ektra, which is basically Kodak's smartphone. It's an Android-based smartphone. We're going to take a look at the box, see what's inside, and then we'll move on to the phone itself. Now, obviously, classic Kodak colours, if you remember, it's the red and yellow logo, these black accents here with this lower portion of the box. There's this nice embossed pattern, which I believe says Kodak. I don't think it says Ektra, just Kodak in various fonts and used by the company over the years. So it's got kind of like the whole point of using the Kodak brand on the smartphone is actually to kind of harken back to its roots in, practical physical photography as well. Bit of information on the side, nothing worth talking about there. And it talks about the smartphone, not really specs or that kind of thing. Talks more about the philosophy behind the smartphone on the bottom here, which is kind of interesting. But we will just jump straight into taking the lid off, and then we have nothing there. The phone itself. Now, obviously, this phone, it's all about the camera, and so the whole back of the phone is covered with the exception of this huge camera arrangement here, which is a 21 megapixel sensor, but I'll get into the specs in just a bit. If I peel this film back, you can see we have the phone itself wrapped up in cellophane, and if I tip it out, it's quite a chunky mother, but it's a nice looking device, nice industrial design on first impressions here, and this brushed finish down the sides. It doesn't feel too heavy. There's a bulge here, which is obviously like a camera grip, so it has that kind of going for it. And you can see there's a micro SD and SIM on the side there, USB at the bottom, it's Type-C USB. Some of the controls, you've got a camera key here, power, volume control, all nicely polished metal elements there again. Metal camera surround, dual tone LED flash, microphone and a headphone jack in the top, and that's about it. So I'm gonna peel these off, that's gone. So it's got this leatherette finish here, which looks very nice, very premium, professional. Take the peel off the lens there. So you can see it's got an optical coating on it as well, which I'll talk about in a little bit. And then take off the cheat sheet on the front. Looks like it's got some buttons below the display. I will turn this on now and let that boot up whilst it's nice to have the little Kodak bar across the screen there, and see what else is in the box. So if I pull up the sheet where the tray holding the phone was, and we have a lift out here. Now, this might have already been unboxed because of, so yours should maybe be a little bit more nicely presented, but you have a, oh, that's nice, you get a lanyard, so you can actually put it through the camera, which I believe it has, right down in the corner here. You can loop the lanyard through there. So you can keep this on your wrist, more like a conventional camera, keep it safe when you're shooting, so there's no chance of dropping your shiny new Kodak Ektra smartphone camera. Then we have a power lead, which as I said is Type-C USB, so it's reversible, always good. It's just one end Type-C, the other end is standard USB. I believe it's USB 3.0 connection, so you get faster data transfer as well. And then we have this power adapter, which I don't believe is fast charging. There's no mention of it. It's using a MediaTek chipset, so I don't know if they have any fast charging tech with the chipset inside this. And then we have a, is this quick start guide? Yeah, quick start guide, multilingual quick start guide, all, everything you need to know about the phone, the hardware, some of the software features, but really it's about playing with it. Last thing there, oh yeah, is also obviously warranty card and the SIM tool too. And that is everything that you get with the Ektra. So now I'm gonna set this phone up very quickly, and then we'll have a quick look around the UI and a bit more about the hardware inside this phone. Okay, so I've set the Ektra up. I haven't actually added any Google account yet, but I just wanted to show you the interface, show you what you can expect from this phone if you decide to pick it up. So let's start with the external hardware first and foremost. So around the edges, we've got this nice, as I said, brushed metal finish, this nice heavily beveled edging as well. Looks really good. Heavily chamfered edging, excuse me. Looks really nice in the light, feels premium. It does feel like some older Kodak devices that we've seen over the years. It clearly draws on some of the Kodak cameras, especially with this leatherette finish as well. As I said, there's this camera grip at the bottom with the loop for a lanyard there, and it feels really good in the hand, obviously easy to hold. It's actually a surprisingly light phone considering it's so big. And there's quite a lot in there as well, but it feels good. All the buttons feel nice to press. The shutter button here, which I believe will probably quick launch the camera, you can push that all the way down. Maybe if you hold it, yeah. If you hold it, it vibrates. Now, I don't know whether I'm, I think I might be snapping photos without actually, no, okay, maybe not. But this is a dual detent shutter button here, so you can half press and then full press, and it actually gives you like a focus point, so you can focus and then fully focus and take the shot with a second press. As I said, you've got the power button, you've got these nice volume controls here. Along this side, you've got just the SIM tray and micro SD tray. So it's, I believe it's a 4G phone. It takes micro SD cards. It's got 32 gigabytes of inbuilt storage, but it is expandable, which is nice. On the top, you have a standard 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. And around the camera on the back, it tells you all about what this kind of module is about. So it's the Kodak Ektra. It's got an f2.0 aperture. It's a 26.5 millimeter 6P lens. It's a 21 megapixel sensor capable of recording in 4K. Video, which is nice thanks to the processor inside, and it uses dynamic PDAF or phase detection autofocus with 6-axis OIS, so it should be really good, especially in low light, despite having technically a slightly narrower aperture than, say, the likes of the Samsung Galaxy S7, which I believe has an f1.8 aperture. But Kodak says that even this optical coating, which you can see the reflection on the lens there, should go some way to improving low light performance and reduce grain and noise when cranking up the ISO as well, which is actually nice to know. If that works in practice, that'd be really good. And it'd also be interesting to see how the OIS helps with both video stabilization and also low light performance too. It also has object tracking when you're taking shots, so focus should be sharp pretty much all of the time. And as I said, face detection, 21 megapixel sensor. If I jump round to the front, there's also a 13 megapixel front facer, can't speak today, that also has phase detection. So both on the front and the back, you get what sounds like pretty decent autofocus chops out the box. Now if I jump to the interface whilst we're here, so this is Android 6.0 Marshmallow. It's pretty much stock. There are a few tweaks and changes, but the most obvious inclusion is Kodak's own app. So that is the folder you can see here has four of the apps, with the fifth being the camera down the bottom there. So that includes the kind of how-to. The Super 8 lets you film video in the style of Super 8, which is quite nice, and it even even gives you an interface that looks like it's a kind of a skeuomorphic interface designed to emulate the Super 8 cameras of days gone by, which is a nice touch out the box. And as well as that, the prints app is quite nice because it obviously lets you take your prints straight from the phone. You can either print them out for delivery or you can print them out for collection at certain stores. You just punch in your address, and that is built into the phone too. So out the box, you are ready to start snapping, and you can even have your prints realized straight away. There's also some other pre-installed apps like Office Suite, AVG, Snapseed for editing your photos, which is something that's talked about. And there's also social integration with Facebook and Twitter without needing to install the apps too. So you can share straight to social media from some of these apps without needing to download them first. So it's all about getting the photos on this phone / camera captured and shared as quickly as possible. Now if I jump back to the hardware, we talked about the cameras, we talked about some of the design. On the front here, we have a 5-inch full HD display, which looks pretty good. It's a little bit dim, viewing angles drop off quite a lot at other angles, but head on, the colors are nice, it looks accurate, it looks perfectly sharp as well and usable. Maybe a little bit brighter would have been nice, but no major issue there. And there's capacitive keys below the display rather than on-screen keys, which is no big deal. It's kind of a matter of personal preference. The bezels are quite big around the display, but if it means that you get a better camera quality because there's more gubbins inside, then I'm okay with that. On the inside, we have a 3000 milliamp hour battery, which should be plenty good for most people to last a day and some. And as I said, it charges via Type-C USB on the bottom there. And the whole show is run by one of the latest Helio chipsets. It's the Helio X20, which came out this year. It's a Deca core chipset. This is pretty much the only phone I've ever come across with a Deca core chipset, backed up by 3 gigabytes of RAM. In general usage, it feels really, really good, really snappy. Nothing crazy to report. MediaTek, the company who make the chipset, say that it should be really good for gaming and all that sort of stuff too. So it's one of their premium chipsets. But typically they benchmark a little bit lower than the likes of Samsung's Exynos chipsets, Huawei's Kirin chipsets, and of course Qualcomm's chipsets too. So it'll be interesting to see how this phone fares in general performance, gaming, and that kind of stuff too. So that is basically, in a nutshell, the Kodak Ektra. The phone was initially unveiled at a pop-up shop in London on December 5th, 2016, and it hit the market the day after, so it's available now for £449, which is a little pricey, but it's kind of getting towards the, you know, the Sony Xperia territory with that kind of price point, and therefore, obviously, you do want to consider once we've tested out this camera, whether it is worthwhile. If you want a Kodak camera phone hybrid, this is obviously the only option out there, but if it is it really the best camera phone on the market? I mean, we're hoping it's going to be good. It promises a lot based on just the visual representation alone, but obviously stay tuned for a full camera review and a full review of the Kodak Ektra. If you have any questions about this phone, just drop us a line down below in the comment section, and yeah, thanks for watching.